We have a project going on. We started about a month ago to replace the cedar siding on the sanctuary here. It was probably about 60 years old, and by inspection up close, you could see a lot of holes, missing pieces. It was really deteriorated, so it absolutely needed to be done. So a couple years ago, we had realized that we needed to do it, so we got a capital campaign going to raise funds from the congregation to pay for the project, which thankfully that was successful. We interviewed a bunch of builders who were recommended to us by Connolly and Hickey here in town. They're well known for their historical renovation work. So one thing we wanted to do with this job was to bring back the look of the original structure, which was built in 1893, I think. The siding that we had on the building, which was put on in like 1960 approximately, was a hand-hewn style, a very rough, uneven look on the shingles. But if you look at this photo, which is from 1901, you could see the original shingles had a much more smoother, refined look, thinner profile. And then around these arches, there was some more decorative elements. So that had been lost in 1960, the last time it was done. So we wanted to bring some of that back to kind of restore as much of the old look as we could.
Our church building gets recorded, painted, drawn by illustrators, photographers. We regularly have professional photographers come by, doing stroll through town, and they always stop by our church to take a picture. And so we know how important our church is from that perspective. And so we want to make sure that we continue to become the conversation piece for town and continue to be one of the photo ops that the books get included.
This is going to have a whole new look. It's going to be brighter and more encouraging, I believe, to have people come and visit us and maybe become a member.
When we met with Anthony Carbone from Timber Ridge to show him the job and see if he'd be interested in bidding on it, he came up and Jim and I were walking him around, and he's kind of gazing up at the building and had like a real appreciation for it. And he said, like audibly but kind of under his breath a little bit, like, "I really want to do this job." Like he really wanted to work on this building and make it look beautiful. And the craftsmen he's brought to work here have been fantastic. They're all so skilled and they're real problem solvers, and we couldn't be happier with the way it's coming out so far.
I mean, when you see the other side that's close to complete, it makes a tremendous difference on the look and feel of the whole corner here in town. So we're progressing from the playground side of the church and coming across the front, and then as we get closer to this point, we have scheduled to bring in an 80-foot boom that we're going to put up on top of the lawn to get to the upper parts of the tower, an area that really hasn't been touched in years and years. The church has done a really great job of keeping up with the painting of the trim and maintaining the siding up to those windows on the midsection. But the upper section hasn't been touched in years. So we don't know what we're going to find when we're up there, but we'll surely just take care of, whatever we come across. Church has also hired somebody, a clock expert, who's going to redo the face and the mechanics of the clocks on all four sides. So that's pretty exciting also. One of the really cool parts of this project are these corners that are all, built in rounded towers. And it's taken a lot of time, energy, and expertise to actually steam and bend the shingles to go around these corners. We've done a really great job in getting the actual, the shingles to go around those corners. This is the steamer box that we're using to steam the cedar shake to go up on those rounded areas. If you take a look inside, we're steaming the shingles on the inside so that they're bendable. And prior to the steaming, they're soaking in a bucket behind.
Uh-huh.
right?
In water?
Just in water. Yeah, regular water. Makes the shakes pliable, so we can bend them around the corner and then they stay that way.
It is cedar. It's Western red cedar. It's, you know, top grade for an exterior application like this. Doesn't need to be painted or stained. Just set it and forget it. It will age over time, and as it weathers, it'll pick up those gray and brown tones that, you know, you're familiar with from houses down to shore up in Cape Cod. I mean, it's a pretty iconic building. It's historical. There's other, you know, synthetic products that are pretty good, but we just wanted to go with the original look. It's more organic, and we just wanted to have the building look like in keeping with how it did when it was first built in 1890. I think, you know, that was kind of important to us and important for the look of Cranford too. Some of the wall, the sheathing underneath the shingles was damaged from water or from animals over the years. So wherever they see that, they're fixing it. There's a pretty significant spot in the front, in fact, that they're gonna work on today where there was a lot of timber that was rotted from water getting in. The one decision we did make is to do this bottom trim dripboard in AZEK, which is a synthetic material which will never rot. It does need to be painted. It'll be painted the same color as the window trim, which is the original, and it's wood, and it'll be patched up where it needs to be, and anything rotten replaced. But this here will be a lifetime. This trim on the bottom will last a lifetime.
I love how they're using copper to go around the top of the window, and also adding copper to you know, to the top there, so that when the water is flowing, it's not flowing back into the wood, but that it's coming down. So mm-hmm. the joy of having this company do it is that they're really meticulous to try to make sure that the project is going to be long lasting, and you know, this. Yeah, we're hoping that it'll go way beyond, you know, 50 years. I mean, you know, this project is not going to happen again in our lifetime.
Right.
The most, for us, as we decided on the renovation, what was really also very important for us, not only preserving our church history, but we understand that our church is located right in the center, heart of Cranford. And most of Cranford literature, photographs contain our church. And we wanted to make sure that, you know, we value also the history of Cranford, that our iconic church remains the way it is, perhaps even preserved, you know, going back in time a little bit. But we're just really excited. The joy of just seeing this is fantastic.
Well, we had a number of projects that we needed to get done. So not only the exterior, but we did the walkways in the front to make them wheelchair accessible, eliminate like a little step that we had by the door. The doors are new, improve our security and functionality. There's a chairlift now for someone who can't negotiate the stairs. Yeah, some downstairs rooms need to be redone. Those are rooms where we have the youth programs and Sunday school and the kids nursery.
This renovation project of the interior and exterior of the church is not just about the church building. The purpose of it is to reach families within Cranford and in the surrounding area to introduce them to Jesus' teachings, to provide a place for families to connect, to provide a sense of community in a world that's become increasingly isolated, and to have fun while doing it. So there are two featured stained glass windows in the church. The first one is called the Good Shepherd window. And in the tradition of churches being built around the turn of the century, windows were dedicated to prominent members or elders of the church. And so the Good Shepherd window is actually dedicated to Josiah Crane, who was instrumental in providing the land that the church is built on. The other window is the Dove window, and also dedicated in memory of Robert Rindell, who was, I believe, a trustee of the church back at the turn of the century.
this octagon structure, the ceiling would, with some lever or some type, it would rise up and let air in. And so that was kind of how that was designed. But I think at a certain time, they just couldn't maintain, keeping things airtight and what have you, prevent the rain from coming in and stuff. So they now permanently fixed it as a ceiling, but at one time the design was to allow the air to come in.
So it's really a cool nod to the turn of the century, the type of architecture that was popular back at the turn of the century is the style that this church is built in. And it's timeless.
What's the style of that church?
It's called Richardsonian Romanesque, which the style of it is like the arches, the pillars, and you'll see some of that architectural style on the exterior of the church as well. So when you look at the main entrance, you see sort of the same idea of the arches. If you saw the picture of the Trinity Church in Boston, it's so eerily similar, but made out of stone.
Most of the churches are going into, with the TV screens, what have you. And also it reduces having to print and use paper. Because lots of the words, lots of the prayers would be on the screen. When I'm preaching, I use it as an aid, whether it's a photo, map, what have you. And so at first, some people were like, is it going to ruin the decor of the front? But then I think once they realized the benefit, and also that it's, it kind of, the black kind of works itself into the front. So the people, we've had nothing but compliments and, praises for the addition of the TVs.
So this is the nursery room, and this is for infants and their parents to come in if they need some quiet time, if they need a diaper change, if we have nursing moms, or if they just need a break. We've got some rocking chairs and they can have tummy time on a blanket on the floor if they want to. And it's just a nice place to come and have some privacy with your infant. At the same time, the church service actually can be heard, so you don't miss anything if you need to come in the nursery with your baby.
This is our children's ministry classroom, and you can see how much effort went into the whole renovation.
These are the tables that the bell choir uses to lay the bells on when they rehearse. And over here is where our choir director directs the choir, who sits there, and our organist, pianist, Bob Grube, sits over there. He's been with the church for 59 years, something like that. This is a multi-purpose room, but its main function is going to be for our youth group, which is kids ages 12 through high school to have their own fun space to meet and do projects, have some snacks, tell faith stories, and just connect in a world that's increasingly disconnected.
And as you can see, we're not completely prepared for it, for the September launch. These are books that we've accumulated to give away and to put away. And we'll mount a large TV in the center as well. To make the learning and the program for this room, be better. So,
what's really neat is we have these murals over here that are painted that are outside the window in the drain hole. But they're really neat.
So tell me about these murals.
So these were the brainchild of Martha Dreyer, who is a church member here. And rather than looking out the window and seeing sort of the window well, she wanted to jazz it up a little bit, as Martha always does. So the best place to find out more information about the church is to visit our website at firstprescranford.org. There is a tab called New Here, where you can actually plan your visit to the church and sign up for a hosted visit where you'll be met by a church member, given a tour, introduced to the pastor, and get a feel for the congregation and what we're about.